So welcome to the Small Business Collaboration Summit, Adam Fisher. I'm absolutely thrilled to have you here. You are partner of Bessemer Venture Partners and are widely regarded as one of the top investors in Israel. You focus on investments in Israel and Europe across multiple technology sectors from pre-revenue, early stage startups to expansion stage growth companies. And some of the portfolio companies that our audience will be familiar with that you have invested in include Pinterest, LinkedIn, Snapdeal, Wix, Shopify, and Box. Now, could I start by getting your thoughts on whether you think that Israel is a naturally collaborative society, and if that, in your opinion, has contributed to the success of Israeli tech ventures globally?
Oh, that's an interesting question. Naturally collaborative? I think so. I mean, there's certainly a history of collaborating and building the country. As you know, the country was founded originally by socialists, who obviously believed in collaboration. But at a certain point, I would say in the late 1980s, it took a different kind of turn, which was much more focused on the individual and on the entrepreneur. And that was kind of a different trend. And that's the source of so much individualism and entrepreneurialism. But I think that collaboration and that kind of kibbutz mentality of kind of not massive scale collaboration, but small scale, tight-knit collaboration, combined with the individual entrepreneurialism, has created a new type of society that is unique.
Now, within your portfolio, have you noticed that the startups that have a more collaborative approach internally within their organization and also in their relation to customer engagement grow faster and further than those that possibly don't?
For sure. I mean, I think, you know, when it comes to collaboration in a startup, it starts with the founders. In many cases, the CEO, who's often the founder, he or she sets the tone. And that kind of collaboration really differs if it's in a kind of employer-employee relationship or if it's really kind of as a team. And of course, the founder is usually typically a much larger shareholder and they can't really get fired. But that approach makes a big, big difference in the quality of the team that they're able to recruit and to retain, and ultimately in the success of the company. Now, it's not a matter of whether the company will be successful or unsuccessful, but how successful and how large and how long can they keep going? Because a startup, the pace of a startup, the intensity of the work is not for everybody. And it's collaboration that I think allows people to feel apart, even when they're owning a very small fraction of what their colleague, or in this case, the CEO of another co-founder owns. With regards to collaboration with customers, that's a bit more difficult. I see two sides to that. Now, I kind of group companies into those that are very customer responsive and will do almost whatever the customer says. But there's always a flip side to that, which is you don't really know what you're doing. You're doing whatever the customer says, and you're going in 100 different directions with no clear focus. On the other hand, we have of course entrepreneurs or companies that have their vision, have their product, could care less what the customer wants, and then are surprised when there's really no interest or they favor the competition. So there's somewhat of a balance where you have to choose. You have to have your focus and your vision for what you think customers should be doing. But you also have to listen to the customer to tweak it, to figure out where there's a right match.
Now, looking at collaboration in your own sector, the venture capital world, I know in Singapore there is collaboration between venture capital funds to go in together as a group, to group fund promising startups. Is that something that also happens in Israel?
Yes, it's not just Israel. It's pretty much the world round. I mean, it's... We call it syndication. So unlike the private equity world, where they're kind of buying out a company, and the only reason to syndicate is usually to share the deal because they need more money. In venture capital, it's not about how much money is needed. We are often a fund that is large enough to fund the company on our own throughout its life cycle. But syndication is a healthy way of doing business. And so almost every other venture capital fund we view as both a competitor, of course, but also a collaborator, which is interesting. Obviously, there'll always be some funds that are only competitors and some that are never competitors and maybe collaborators. But by and large, you know, every VC is considered a potential partner, and therefore we meet with them all the time, irrespective of having a deal together or looking at a deal together. And when it comes to working together, you know, sometimes it's as equal partners where we both invest a similar amount. But even when that's not the case, when we've already, for instance, we've already invested $10 million and now there's a subsequent financing round and another fund comes in and they lead a round, they may ultimately invest more than we do in dollar terms. But because the valuation has gone up in the company, we still may be the larger owner. But when we set the table at the board of the directors, we just see each other as kind of colleagues, mutual interest. And it's not one of, it's really a view of collaboration and trying to get the other's thoughts. It's not one of I own more than you or you're the leader and whatever you do, you know, we'll listen. It's definitely collaboration.
There's a wonderful page on your website where you honor the rock star startups that Bessemer rejected and chose not to invest in. It makes for very entertaining reading. Is your decision making a mix of gut and brain? And if so, what are the top three things that you want to see in a prospective early stage venture that will pique your interest in investment?
Yes, gut versus brain. I mean, for sure, it may be our brain. Obviously, we're not thinking with our gut, but there's some things we can't put our finger on, both in terms of why we may like something and are willing to take a certain risk, but also many times in why we don't feel comfortable. We may think we know the reason, but there's often something else there. Now, a lot of it comes down to personality, chemistry with the founders. Sometimes you can't put your finger on it, but even though you have no evidence of this person not being transparent or not being truthful, or there may be something about the person that just doesn't make you feel comfortable. You know, when we invest, we have a very long-term view of it. Not only investing large sums of other people's money, including our own, which itself is scary, but we're getting involved with somebody and multiple people who have quite a bit of control of this company, and that can be for a very long time. So you're really committing yourself to working for 5, 7. I mean, I've had companies where I've been involved for 11, 12 years. Mm-hmm. Now, I don't know about you, but that's very hard to think that far ahead in terms of where you want to work and without the ability to leave, which is the truth. We can't leave. You can't just sell your stake. You can't quit when you're responsible for managing somebody else's money that you've already invested. And so oftentimes that's where kind of the gut will come in. In other cases, it's the other way around. You're so enthralled by the entrepreneur. You know that the business is still young and there are so many questions, but you say, you know, there's just something about this person or something about what they're doing that I can't explain it all, but I feel like they're going to figure it out. Now, that's not really a brain, you know, that may make sense of brain, but it's not a really good explanation. I mean, somebody else is going to say, yeah, I think you're right. You know, it's just, that's gut. That's what I think we mean by gut.
Yeah.
And for sure we do that, especially at the early stage. And I think I pride myself on being able to do that rather well, whether that's a lucky streak or not, you know, maybe time will eventually tell. But it's a big part of investing. And I think what entrepreneurs don't entirely grasp is that there is that sense of personal chemistry that you can't ignore. And it's hard both for the investor, but also for the entrepreneur to go with somebody that is quite different from themselves. And certainly it happens, but we naturally gravitate to work people with this chemistry.
And my final question, how do you believe that collaboration has contributed to your own success in business?
Yeah, so in our world as a venture capitalist, I mean, every fund is a bit different. Some are more collaborative, where they are a partnership, where they have to have consensus, where everybody has to kind of sign off, everybody has to meet the company. And if somebody rejects the deal, you don't do it. We're a partnership that is, due to its history and culture and due to its size, we give a lot of autonomy to each individual deal maker or partner. to invest, regardless of what some of the other punters think. We try and influence one another, but we don't veto or encourage somebody to do something, because we kind of give them the ability to decide and the responsibility if it doesn't go well. But in terms of my own career, you know, it's very easy to take that autonomy, whether it's within your partnership or once you've invested on the board, to be very opinionated. We're known as fairly opinionated people. We've got money to kind of back it up, and it makes people, you know, it empowers us, and sometimes too much so. And it's very easy to be nasty, not intentionally, but to annoy people, to pontificate, to do all kinds of things that would otherwise turn off, whether it's the founders or other management or other investors. And so I think when it comes to collaboration, I've always had the view, I've always been a very individual kind of worker. I do as much as I can on my own, because I feel like, you know, I'm making a decision to invest. I have to know everything. I can't simply rely on somebody else saying, oh, I've checked that. I really need to know. So, but there is always a level of collaboration. But I think where collaboration has really made an impact with me, it's been with the founders that I invest in, with the management teams of my companies, and even with the co-investors. I really try and give them as much respect as possible, sometimes regardless of whether they give me that same respect back, regardless of whether they're smaller than us or bigger than us as a fund, whether they're better investors or have a worse track record. So I think that would fall under the term collaboration, because I do think it's sometimes I struggle to collaborate, because it's not warranted. But I do know that long term, giving people that feeling is what makes them want to continue to invest alongside me, or as an entrepreneur to take money from me, or just as an individual to refer other people to me, because ultimately it's not the fact that we have access to capital that makes me or Bessemer interesting. It's our reputation, and that's easily tarnished. So I think collaboration is a key attribute of what brings people back to me over and over again.
Well, Adam Fisher, thank you so much for being with us here today at the Small Business Collaboration Summit. We have some wonderful emerging businesses on bizzi that I hope one day may pique your interest and be the next startup. So that's really our hope for our community here, to grow and thrive and get insights from entrepreneurs like yourself through this summit. So thank you so much. I am eternally grateful for the time that you have given us today. Thank you.
Great.